On the Tungsis Trail in Burlington, Connecticut, stands a reminder of this area's colonial past. This is the Tory Den. During the Revolutionary War, this cave of tumbled boulders was the hiding place for local loyalists known as Tories, who were escaping persecution at the hands of their patriot neighbors. Those citizens who remained loyal to the crown were arrested, tarred and feathered, whipped, tortured, and harassed. And this area, known at the time as Chippenny Hill, was a Tory stronghold. Many residents here were members of the Church of England, and they refused to give up their allegiance to the crown. And for this, these men were hated by those seeking independence. And the Sons of Liberty were particularly brutal in their treatment of the loyalists. So when the Sons of Liberty would come to Chippenny Hill, an alarm would sound, and the loyalists of the area would climb to this remote ridge and hide in the Tory Den. With no fire for warmth or light, for fear that the smoke would reveal their hiding place, they sat in silence, waiting for the all-clear signal that the Sons of Liberty had moved on, and it was safe to return to their homes. Historian E. Leroy Pond tells the story of the Tory Den in his book, The Tories of Chippenny Hill, Connecticut. Here is his description of the men who hid here. "Come, O rocks of the ledges, and tell me who of the Tory clan came oftenest to the den. First of all, there was Stephen Graves of Harwinton, and many a time did he run from his log cabin to hide himself beneath its moss-grown roof. And many a time, doubtless, did the secret meeting of men that he was harboring adjoin hither post-haste. His home was nearer to it than were any of the Chippenny Hill farmhouses, and therefore it is possible that it was he who discovered it in the first place. It was Ruth Graves, his young wife, who fed the men in the den. She carried the food from the home and left it for them on a flat rock near the edge of the woods, for she dared not risk betrayal by going nearer. I wonder if there was anyone in the cave the night Joel Tuttle crawled into the entrance. The day before, he hung by the neck from an oak tree on the Federal Hill Green at New Cambridge. Captain Thomas Hungerford, a patriot neighbor, whose name was later appears as a fellow churchman, cut him down, and he lay at the foot of the tree, insensible, until sometime in the night, when he so far revived as to be able to make his way to the cave in the ledges, about 4 miles distant. I wonder how many of the Tuttle family saw the inside of the cave. There was Simon Tuttle, an old man, and Daniel his son. Daniel went openly over to the Tory forces, and his land and homestead were confiscated by the state of Connecticut and sold at public venue. Ebenezer had a son, born in January 1775, and was given the name Constant Loyal Tuttle. And there were the Carringtons, Lemuel and Riverius. The Carringtons always loved the old and delighted in saying so. Lemuel afterwards kept a tavern on the hill, and Lois, his sister, once heated a great kettle of water for the purpose of giving the patriot raiders a warm reception. But they did not come. That was almost too bad, for if she was a true Carrington, she certainly would have thrown the water, and she lived to a ripe old age to tell about it. Then there was Captain Nathaniel Jones, an elderly sea captain who lived on the very summit of the hill. It was the grandniece of Captain Jones who testified that the Tory hunters used to go about visiting cellars and pantries and destroying provisions, thus doing what they could to starve the women and children. And there were the Matthewses, good folk, of whom any community might be proud, who loved the church and were leaders in its services. I wonder if they were driven to the ledges too, and the Jeromes. Ruth Graves was a Jerome. She and her brothers, Zerubbabel and Chauncey, were the loyalist members of the adventurous family. Chauncey was a young man and lived on Fall Mountain, which rises far off on the southern horizon. The den was a very long way from his home, and had it not been for Jonathan Pound, his brother-in-law, he would once have suffered severely for that very free tongue of his. They caught him on the mountain and led him to an apple tree, with his shirt up over his head, then strung him up by the thumbs to a limb, his feet barely touching the ground. They selected a strong hickory rod and struck a terrific blow. Tradition says that a scar was left on the tree where the rod came down. Athletic Chauncey Jerome had torn from his bonds with a leap, leaving his shirt hanging on the tree. And in his small clothes, he ran like a deer down the mountain. He sought refuge in the house of Jonathan Pond, who stood, gun in hand, at the door and commanded the pursuers not to enter. Chauncey Jerome finally went to Nova Scotia to live until the war was over, and he outlived most of his contemporaries and always bore the name Jerome the Tory. And so there you have it. The Sons of Liberty never did find the location of the Tory Den. Chippenny Hill is now known as Chippin's Hill, and these once remote ledges are now a popular hiking spot where Tory Den stands right on the trail's edge. See you next time.